All right, y'all. New mug. This one's legit. It's official. What's shaking, bacon? I'm Joni Simon. Welcome to my studio. This is where I do food photography, and the goal here is to improve your food photography skills so you can feel confident behind the camera. Like you can see, we are playing with sparklers here today. Now, of course, we've got to do the big, huge, giant warning, right? Don't do this at home, or do this at home only if it's legal, because sparklers and fireworks are not legal everywhere, so don't break the law. But if you can play with sparklers, also promise me that you're gonna be super duper careful, because it's not advised to do sparklers indoors. I did them indoors. Just take proper precautions. Promise me that you are not gonna harm yourself or others or the building or anything like that. So be careful. Today I have busted out some turquoise cupcakes for y'all to show off some sparkler techniques, things that I have learned over the years, and some things actually that I learned while I was shooting these that I thought y'all are gonna need to know this. It's gonna make things so much easier so you can get those perfect sparkler shots. So tip number one, first thing that I like to do, I mean, certainly we get all of our scene set up, we know what we're shooting, we've got a game plan just like any photo shoot. But one of the things when it comes to sparklers, depending on the subject you're shooting, in this situation I'm shooting cupcakes, which are pretty small. In that situation, I actually end up cutting down the sparklers so that they're not quite so like high off the cupcake, right? Because when you just like insert the sparkler with its standard stem kind of into the cupcake, it's like way too high. And so from a composition standpoint, it might be way off. Now, if you're shooting a drink or you're shooting a cake or something that's taller, maybe you don't need to cut it down. But then I also cut the top part of it down for this cupcake in specific, because again, I just wanted to lower that height. But two, as you'll see, when the sparkler starts to burn down, you get kind of that not so cute top on it. And so if your top is shorter, you'd get the shot kind of sooner as it starts to burn, and you don't end up with that like janky top part. So just a little tip, you can cut that down, just use some wire cutters, which to me are something super duper helpful to have in your studio in general. Tip number two is to shoot on a tripod. Now, absolutely, you can shoot sparklers freehand. There's not anything inherently problematic about freehand or on a tripod, but one of the nice things that will make more sense when we get further into the video is that when it comes to sparklers, they sort of like burn in an inconsistent manner. There's moments, like if you start to shoot them, you'll see that there's like tons of sparks happening, and then there's little, like not a lot of sparks happening. And so we wanna kind of get that really nice, like perfect little spray of sparks. And so taking a lot of shots in succession, or even what we're gonna do at the end of this video, is combine multiple shots together to get the best sparks from different images. And so the easiest way to create those composite images is for all the image to stay exactly the same and to not move in terms of the scene. So doing that on a tripod. Tip number three is to put your camera into high speed continuous shooting mode. Chances are, depending on how you've set up your camera, how you've programmed it, your settings might be that you've got it in just like a single shot. So you push the shutter button and it takes an image. But what you can do is you can put it in a continuous shooting mode where you hold down the shutter button and it will continue to fire shots. Now, depending on your camera, depending on, you know, the number of shots per second that it can take, whether you're shooting RAW or JPEG or how big a file, all these sort of different things will determine how many shots you're getting out in successive timing. But regardless of that, it is just nice to be able to shoot your sparklers with sort of that rapid fire shooting mode so that we can get multiple shots as that little guy starts to burn down. Tip number four then is to base your exposure on the brightness of a flame, right? Because what's gonna happen is, say for example, you set up your scene and you base your exposure just kind of purely on the scene, that's great. But here's what's gonna happen is that you're gonna light that sparkler and it's gonna burn super duper bright. And so just to ensure that that's not getting like super overexposed. Now, granted, it's a sparkler, it's a super bright, intense light, and so there will be some overexposure within that sparkler probably in the final image, but it is good just to kind of do a little test as you're getting your exposure set and making those decisions to just like, I light a little flame and I base the exposure on that. Now, of course, there's going to be different considerations for your exposure depending on if you're shooting with just, you know, the available light or a continuous light source or strobe. In general, good to set that initial exposure based on the brightness of a flame. Now, for this particular particular shot, I started at F9. I always set my aperture first. So that's gonna really help because that's so informed based on the subject specifically that I'm shooting. And so in this case, thinking of this scene, you know, I wanted some softness in the scene, but I still wanted to be able to see some sort of definition of the surrounding cupcakes. I didn't want them to be like formless blobs in the background. So F9 allowed me to do that in consideration of the fact that I am using the 105 millimeter macro lens. I'm considerably close up to the subject. And so as we've talked about in previous videos, the closer you are to the subject, the more pronounced that depth of field effect is gonna be. So stopping down to F9 is allowing me to get the definition I want out of the surrounding subjects while also ensuring that the front of the cupcake is in focus. And then also where I've inserted that sparkler, that the sparkler is also in focus, right? Because we think about that field, that plane of focus, that we want to make sure that it reaches far enough back that we've got enough depth to get our sparkler and our cupcake in focus. Tip number 5, and this is also a camera setting, and this is the camera setting that will have the greatest impact on the way that your sparklers look in your final image, and that is the shutter speed. Now, I'm not going to give you like an exact shutter speed to set your camera to because there's really a variety of different factors that are going to impact the shutter speed that you're going to want to select. So I just want to give you kind of the framework so you can make the decisions based on what you're looking to do. But you know, if you read articles or if you've ever experimented with and shot fireworks on like the 4th of July or New Year's, like the big ones up in the sky, you're always going to want to go with a slower shutter speed, right? So that we get those motion trails so that we can see as like the sparks of the fireworks are coming down in the sky that it creates kind of like that, I don't know, what does that look like a palm tree sort of effect, right? So some of that same sort of thing applies here for our sparklers. We want a little bit of that trail, right? From when the spark starts here to moves here, that the duration of time is able to capture that as these cool little streaks. That looks really cool. But we want to make sure in the situation with sparklers is we don't want to be exposing like half second, full second, like we would be with fireworks because we're so physically close to them. The speed at which things are moving and changing is much more rapid. So we want to dial that in so that we get a little bit of those streaks, a little bit of those motion, but not so much that it just ends up like this big bright blob and blur. But overall, the thing to keep in mind is that the longer your shutter speed, the longer those trails will be. And the shorter, the faster your shutter speed, the shorter those trails will be, right? You just think if the shutter is open for a long time, we get a lot of movement and action going on. And so we get to see all of that trail. But there is definitely like sort of this break-even place at which you're like, ah, that's too long. That's overtaking my image. That's too much. So now you might also be thinking, for those of you who shoot flash-based photography, you think, well, the action in flash is kind of frozen by that flash duration, right? And that is absolutely true. But because our sparklers are so bright and so fast that they don't apply in the same way, that we are not canceling out that ambient exposure that's coming from those sparklers. So you also, even if you are shooting with flash, you will see that you'll still get those motion trails just because purely the brightness of that sparkler. So it is going to look slightly different if you're shooting these with flash versus shooting these with a continuous light source or with a natural light source. But all that to say, no matter what light you're shooting with, longer shutter speeds, open for a longer time, longer trails. Now for me personally, and the look that I like best, and again, everybody's got their own tastes and what they're looking for and the point of the image and what you're trying to accomplish. For me personally, I found that I like the shots the best in the 1/60th range up to about the 1/125th, up to maybe 1/200th, but I felt like that 160, 180, 1/100th of a second space like gave me enough movement and motion that I got some of that burst, but it wasn't overtaking the image, right? Because at the end of the day, the image for me in this situation is all about that cupcake, right? The cupcake is the subject. The sparkler is more so meant to just be like the little garnish on top. So we don't want it to necessarily be like all about the sparkler. Now, of course, if this image that you're shooting is all about the sparkler and there's no food in the shot, well then you've got a lot more room to play with. But for me to kind of keep things dialed in and tight. But what you'll notice too, again, like we talked about, and the reason that we want to shoot multiple shots is because different, like as that sparkler starts to burn down, there's going to be wider bursts and smaller bursts, and it's really going to vary as that thing burns down. So giving yourself that high speed continuous shooting, shooting on a tripod, and keeping that shutter speed somewhere in the neighborhood of 1/60th to 1/100th of a second, you're going to have a lot of good options in order to then put all these images together in post. Tip number six is to take plenty of test shots. For me personally, I went through two boxes of sparklers for this video. Part of that was because I was creating this video for educational purposes, and so I really wanted to experiment with a lot of different shutter speeds, try a lot of different things out, a lot of different scenarios. So you probably may not go through as many as I did, but it definitely helps, like before you've introduced the food to the scene, before you've got everything ready, like just play around with, find where is your personal sweet spot, because two, the different sparklers kind of burn differently from manufacturer to manufacturer. There's gonna be different environmental impacts. There's gonna be all sorts of different things that are gonna really impact the decision you make with that shutter speed. So definitely pays to experiment with it and to take plenty of test shots. Tip number seven, to make your life a whole lot easier in post, is to make sure to shoot a plate. So what I mean by that, in this particular situation, I had the whole scene, finally had everything dialed in, where I wanted the cupcakes, where I wanted the props, how I wanted the lighting to be. I knew the exposure was gonna work. Everything was pretty much good to go before I light that all important sparkler. I took a shot of the scene before burning the sparkler, because here's what you also have to know, is that bless those sparklers, once you light them, they also like kick off all this like soot and not so tasty stuff that will end up on your food. So from the standpoint of like actually serving food after it's had actual sparklers on it, not so advisable in real life. But when it comes to photography in this situation, you know, it looks beautiful, but what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna have this plate where the cupcake is perfect and pristine. It hasn't been affected. It doesn't have soot on it. So then in post, then I can take the best shots of the sparkler going down and little sparks coming off the sides and combine those all together then with that perfect cupcake before I started the lighting process. Because two, it also gets worse and worse, right? Like if you end up lighting multiple sparklers over the same cupcake as I did in the process of building this shot, by the end, you end up with a hot mess of a cupcake. So be sure if you're gonna jump into Photoshop, you're gonna composite your images, make sure to shoot a plate. Even shooting one too with no cupcake so that you've just got the scene, it's always helpful insurance to make sure that your post process is gonna be a lot easier. Now, just to walk you through all the different shots that actually went into making up this final image, you can see as I just turn these off and turn these on what each individual layer added to this shot. So of course we've got like that perfected cupcake, we've got the final like full sparkler that I liked the best out of about 85 shots that I took. This was the one where I felt like, oh, it had just the right spray and the right spread, but then I supplemented from some extra sparks from some extra shots. You can see adding those in there on this side, and then up in the corner, this is where I got a little crafty. I was thinking outside the box for you, is that I thought it'd be really fun to have a little bit of like bokeh effect and as if the sparks were kind of flying out at us or flying up out of the scene. They didn't do that in real life, but then what I did is after I'd gotten all the shots, then I took the aperture and adjusted it down to f5.6, and then I took the sparkler and kind of like moved it around, like I inserted it from above the frame and put it around the frame but slightly out of focus so that I knew I'd have those really cool like kind of orbs on the side that just kind of to me add this sort of magical little feeling that I wanted to infuse in this image anyway. It's got sort of this little magic vibe with all the little stars and sprinkles. It just, you know, went full tilt magic on this. Perhaps an optimistic ode to 2021. But you can just see that then that allowed me then in post to add one more frame, which then I could just paint those in with the layer mask and end up with this really cool final shot. But otherwise, the rest is completely up to you and your own personal experimentation, adding your own flair and your own taste. Playing with sparklers can absolutely add a ton to photos. And I hope this has given you some fun ideas to play with. Again, be careful. Don't burn yourself. Don't burn your set. Don't burn your backgrounds. Promise me you'll be careful. But with that, I hope you have a fantastic week. You stay out of trouble. I'll see you soon, okay? Bye.